this lecture, we will see the formation of energy bands in solids. As per their electrical conductivity, solids can be mainly divided into three categories. First one is metal. Second one is insulator. And the third one is semiconductors. And we all know that metals have very high electrical conductivity and very low resistivity. Whereas insulators have very high electrical resistivity but very low electrical conductivity. At the same time, semiconductors have electrical resistivity or conductivity in between these metals and insulators. And we also know that according to band theories, these insulators, metals or semiconductors can be further divided as per their band structures. And in this image, we can see in insulators, there are some bands that are completely filled and other bands are completely empty. Here, this blue color is showing filled band and this box is showing empty band. And in insulator, there is a large energy gap or band gap between filled and empty band, and this filled band is known as valence band, whereas this empty band is known as conduction band. So in insulator, the gap between valence band and conduction band is very high. At the same time, we can see in metals, some bands are completely filled, but remaining bands are partially filled. Or here we can see that there is an overlapping between valence band and conduction band. In semiconductor, if we take semiconductor at as absolute zero temperature, we can see the configuration of bands are similar to insulators, where some bands are completely filled and remaining bands are completely empty. But the energy gap or band gap between valence band and conduction band is smaller as compared to the insulators. But at room temperature or higher temperature, semiconductors have bands, those looks like metals. That is, some bands are completely filled and other bands are partially filled. So at high temperature, semiconductors can behave like metals, and at absolute zero temperature, semiconductors can behave like insulators. But there are other solids also which are known as semi-metal, and here we can see at even at absolute zero temperature, these solids have bands, those are almost filled and almost empty, and there is an overlapping between these bands. So such type of solids are known as semi-metal, and this is the main difference between these semi-metal and semiconductor. I am repeating it, that semiconductors have completely empty and completely filled band at zero temperature or absolute zero temperature, but semi-metals have partially filled bands or partially empty bands even at zero temperature. And the example of semi-metal is bismuth. Bismuth is a good example of semi-metal. So in this lecture, we will first look why this energy gap is coming, and then we will see how do these bands are formed, and third, we will see why there is a larger band gap in insulator and why there is an overlapping between valence band and conduction band in metals, and why there is a smaller band gap between valence band and conduction band. So our first aim is to know the origin of this energy gap. So for knowing this origin of energy gap, first let us consider nearly free electron model. Nearly free electron model, and we know that a free electron or nearly free electron can take energy Ek, and the formula for energy can be written as h cross square k square by 2m. And if we can see here that a free electron can take energy from 0 to infinity, and that energy is continuous, there is no breaking. And if we draw wave function for this energy or this free electron, we can write wave function like psi k r, which is equal to exponential iota k r. And we can see this wave function is similar to traveling wave, or we can say that a free electron behaves like a traveling wave with momentum p, which is equal to h cross k. So from here we can see that a free electron can take energy from zero to any energy from zero to infinity, and its wave function looks like a traveling wave. And when we make a graph between this E and K, we can find a graph like this graph A. Here we can also see that E can be from 0 to infinity any value, and there is always continuous value of E. But when we talk about the nature of electrons in crystal, we have to consider the periodic potential of crystal. And due to this periodic potential, there is some forbidden band or energy band that come into the picture. So for this, if we take a rough example, let's say this is a crystal with lattice constant A. We know that a free electron can behave as a traveling wave. But when we think about crystal, the traveling wave behavior will be changed. Let's say first electron is moving like a traveling wave in this direction, but at the boundary of the crystal. Here I am showing the physical boundary of the crystal, but actually this is happening in K space. So at the zone boundary, this electron gets reflected back into this direction, and at another zone boundary, this electron again gets reflected back into this direction, and again there is a reflection which is known as Bragg reflection. So in crystal, electrons or electron behaves like standing waves. Instead of traveling waves, so this is the main difference between a free electron and electron in crystal. In a free electron can behave like a traveling wave, but in crystal that electron behaves like standing waves. And due to these standing waves, this energy gap occurs. So first let me introduce the Bragg reflection condition. Bragg reflection condition. Which is like A plus G whole square, which is equal to A square, where G is a reciprocal lattice vector. And G is equal to 2 pi n by a. Here we are considering a linear crystal with lattice constant a. Here we are considering a linear crystal with lattice constant A. This is the Bragg condition for diffraction of wave vector K or reflection of wave vector K. And here N is integer. In one dimension, K can be written as plus minus half g, which is equal to plus minus n pi by a. So from this condition, we can see that first reflection will be occurred at where k is equal to plus minus pi by a. So the region, if I am taking this is 0, so first reflection is occurring at where the boundaries of this pi by a and minus pi by a, and this region between pi by a and minus pi by a is known as first Brillouin zone. And Bragg reflection is also happening at these surfaces at minus pi by a and plus pi by a. So due to these reflections at this boundary, we can say that the wave functions at k, which is equal to plus minus pi by a, are not the traveling waves . And what is traveling waves? We can write a traveling wave like this, exponential iota pi x by a in one direction, and other direction we can write it as exponential minus iota pi x by a. Of free electrons. And we can note that at these spatial points, of k, the wave functions are made up of equal parts of waves traveling to the right and to the left when the Bragg reflection condition that is k equal to plus minus pi by a is satisfied. By the wave vector, a wave traveling to the right is Bragg reflected. To travel to the left and vice versa. And a wave that travels neither to the right nor to the left is known as standing wave. And we can also say that a standing wave does not go anywhere. And if we take time independent state and the time independent state is represented by these standing waves. Here, since there are two traveling waves, one is going into right direction and other is going into left direction. So using these two different standing waves, we can form two different standing waves. So there are two traveling waves, that is, first one is exponential pulse iota pi x by a, and we can write it as cos of pi x by a pulse iota sine of pi x by a, this is going into one direction, and another traveling waves that we can write as minus iota pi x by a, which can be written as cos of pi x by a minus iota sine pi x by a. So this is going into one direction and this is going in opposite direction. So from these two traveling waves, we can form two standing waves. So standing waves are like this, if you represent it psi plus, which is equal to exponential iota pi x by a plus exponential minus iota x pi by a. That is, first we have to add these waves, and in second time we will subtract these two waves, so which is equal to two cos pi x by a and other wave and another standing wave can be written as psi minus, which is equal to the difference of these two traveling waves, exponential iota pi x by a minus exponential minus iota pi x by a, which is equal to 2 iota sine pi x by a. And here we can see that this plus sign shows that this wave is symmetrical. When we put x or minus x, the sign of this wave will remain same. But here this wave is not symmetrical, and when we put x or minus x, the sign of this wave will change accordingly. And we can see these two standing waves are composed of equal parts of right and left directed traveling waves. And we will see that these standing waves psi plus and psi minus pile up the electrons at different regions. And therefore, the two waves have different values of the potential energy. In the field, of ions of the lattice. And this is the origin of the energy gap. So if we take probability density, we know that the probability density rho of a particle can be written as that is psi, which is equal to rho, which is equal to psi star psi, and which is equal to psi whole square. And for a pure traveling wave, this rho or probability density will be like exponential minus iota kx and exponential plus iota kx, which is going to be 1. So for this is important point, for traveling wave the probability density is always 1, and therefore the charge density is constant in the region. And similarly, if we take probability density for that psi plus or plus standing wave, we can write it as psi plus square, which is directly proportional to cos square pi x by a. And similarly, we can take probability density for other standing wave by squaring this, and this is directly proportional to sine square pi x by a. And from here we can see these standing waves has maximum probability at different point, because if a cos wave is going like this, a sine wave is like this, so these two waves have maximum probability at different points or different parts. So this wave or let me write it here or we can say that the psi plus function or the cos function piles up the electrons that is negative charge the positive ions centered at x equal to 0, A, 2A, and so on, where the potential energy is lowest. And for the other standing wave, the probability density, which is directly proportional to sine square, concentrate the electrons away from the ion cores. This is the main reason, and these two points are very important to understand. In this image, this is the electrostatic potential energy curve, and here we can see that the potential energy is negative around ions because there is a attraction between electrons and ion cores, and we know that ion cores have a positive charge. And this image is very important to understanding this concept. Here we know that the probability density for traveling wave is 1. So here we can see this, since this traveling wave will concentrate all the charges equally at every point, or the charge distribution due to this traveling wave is constant everywhere. But a standing wave, that is with plus sign, will concentrate the charges on the positive ions centered at x equal to 0, A, 2A, and so on. We can see this is a cos wave, and at the same time the other standing wave, this one with dotted lines, concentrate the charges in different regions. So when we calculate potential energy for this wave, that is psi plus wave and psi minus wave, we can get a difference in energy. The one energy due to this psi plus is lower than this traveling wave, and the energy for psi minus wave is higher than for this traveling wave. So here, due to concentration of charges different at different places, this is the main reason for this energy gap. And in last figure, here the region of rho minus probability density and rho plus probability density differ by a energy gap Eg, and just below the gap at points this A, the wave function is psi plus. This here wave function is psi plus, and just above the gap, that is at points B, the wave function is psi minus. Since different standing waves concentrate the charges at different region around the ions, so due to this difference in the charge density, there is a difference in the potential energy, and due to this difference we can see an energy gap. I'm sure you are able to understand this concept. And we can also calculate this difference or this gap. We know that energy gap or energy in quantum mechanics first we have to write this potential energy. Let me write it in the form of U cos 2 pi x by a. This is the potential energy of an electron in the crystal at point x, and the first order energy difference between the two standing waves can be written as Eg, which is equal to integration 0 to 1 ux psi plus square minus psi minus square dx. That is, we can calculate potential energy for this psi plus wave function and potential energy for sine minus wave function, and when we subtract these two functions we can get this energy difference, and which is equal to 2 dx u cos of 2 pi x by a cos square pi x by a minus sine square pi x by a, which is equal to u. So here we see that the gap is equal to the Fourier component of the crystal potential. This is the crystal potential and this is the Fourier transform Fourier component of the crystal potential. So In this way, we can calculate this energy gap. So now we have to understand the energy band formation. I think we can take this into next lecture.